Recent news of yet another school shooting has left many parents and caregivers asking themselves, how do we talk to young children about violence at school? To help get more insight and more direction on how to tackle difficult conversations like this, I'm joined by pediatric psychologist Jeff Shahidullah. Jeff, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
I want to start off by asking you, what's the best way to start this kind of conversation?
I think for young kids, the news is something that can be really difficult to watch and then understand. And particularly since the most tragic and scary and sensational stories are often what's reported, but kids are always listening. They hear what caregivers and adult siblings and classmates are talking about. And so for older kids, they'll certainly see news clips on their phones and YouTube. So I start there and see if you can pick up on what they're hearing, what their friends are saying, and if there are any inaccuracies in what they've heard.
Once you do have a clear understanding of what your child knows or doesn't know, what should you do with that information? How can that be helpful?
So what I'll do typically is just get a sense of their reaction to the news and how they're feeling. And then the first thing that I might try to do is just acknowledge and validate their emotions, whatever they are. Show that you're taking their questions, their concerns, their feelings seriously. And it's important to not minimize or dismiss their concerns or feelings, since that can make them feel like they're not valid and that they just need to suppress them and keep them to themselves in the future. So for example, you might say, hey, it looks like you may be feeling a bit sad. It's normal to feel sad when we see people getting hurt, or it's normal to feel scared or worried when you see a scary thing happening at school that looks like yours, and to think, what if that happened where I'm at my school? And we've got to remember that kids, especially younger kids, may believe what happens to other people that they see on TV can easily happen to them.
What should you do if what your child has heard isn't entirely true?
Yeah, that's a great question, and that may often be the case. I think it's great to start with hearing what they've heard. You can let them know that there may not always be truthful information that they get on news sites or from their friends. So I think that's a good conversation to have. And then also another thing that I try to keep in mind when I work with kids is that oftentimes there are not black and white answers. So sort of the language that I might use with kids is, yes, it's extremely unlikely that anything like that will ever happen to you. And at the same time, it's normal for our brains, or for kids, I might say our worry brains is sometimes how I'll label it. It's normal for our worry brains to still be a bit worried about something bad happening, because that's what worry brains do. They want us to be safe and not caught off guard if something dangerous did happen. So acknowledging that some fear and worry is okay is a first step in teaching kids that they can accept their own strong emotions by first naming it, I'm feeling scared or worried. And then next, knowing why we feel it. So it's the concept of sometimes you have to name it to tame it. Acknowledge that it's happening, name the emotion, realize that it's okay and normal to feel that emotion, and that if I don't try to fight against it or suppress it, it will eventually just pass.
Death and dying are also topics that tend to come up when we're talking about school shootings and violence. How do you explain death and dying to some of the youngest and most impressionable people in our lives, children?
Don't be afraid to have the conversation, even though it's a very uncomfortable conversation to have. Part of having the conversation around death and dying in a safe space at a developmentally appropriate level is actually giving kids practice and exposure to dealing with it when it really happens in the future. And they may have to deal with it on their own. So I think about having the conversations about death and dying. I also think about something that comes up in my practice a lot that parents ask me about is, what about when my kids have thoughts of death and suicidal thoughts? Again, that's another one of those hard conversations for parents to have. No parent wants to have it, but it goes back to that acknowledge and validate approach that we discussed earlier, where you might right off the bat thank the kid for bringing it up. And at the end of the day, while these are not easy conversations to have with kids, we probably wish we weren't having these conversations, we would rather our kid feel safe bringing them up to us rather than keeping it all inside and not sharing it with anyone, and then them not getting the support that they may need.
It also begs the question, should the parent or caregiver bring it up first, whether it's death and dying or death by suicide. Obviously, as you mentioned, they're very difficult and sometimes blindsiding things to have to talk to, especially unplanned, with a child. Is there a reason to bring it up first? And if so, how do you start that conversation?
You want to be able to bring it up in a space where you can make sure that the kids get the facts that you feel like they need. And if they see that we are uncomfortable talking about death and dying and suicidal thoughts, then the kids might think that, hey, this is something that is uncomfortable and I should feel uncomfortable bringing it up. But ultimately, we're recognizing that suicidal thoughts, thoughts of death, are just thoughts. Having suicidal thoughts doesn't mean that the child is going to translate those into action. In fact, that typically doesn't happen. So treating our difficult, scary thoughts like suicide, like death and dying, just as we do any other thoughts, teaches the kids that we can notice that we're having the thought, but we don't have to give any special power or control to the thought. One of the things that I recommend to a lot of the families that I work with is every day doing something called feelings talk time. And it could be dedicated time. It could be time in the car, going to school or practice, where you just turn off the radio and you can offer a kid, hey, you know, this is feelings talk time. You know, I'm not going to force you to talk about something, but if you want, there could be like maybe an incentive. And then over time, the kids may get more comfortable bringing up their own strong negative thoughts, feelings, and emotions when they have this dedicated space carved out into the day. And they don't have to sort of figure out what's the right time, because parents, you're already making that safe space.
My mom used to always say, life is not a dress rehearsal. And for parents and caregivers, that's kind of a double-edged sword, because on the one hand, you know, it's the expression or thought of living life to the fullest. On the other hand, you know, it's that added pressure of feeling like you only get one shot at setting a child up for success, which begs the question for parents and caregivers, how do you know if you're doing it right, if you're doing the right things to have these conversations or prepare your child for what the world holds, be that school or otherwise?
One of my mantras as a pediatric psychologist I always try to keep in mind is all kids only get one childhood. And as a parent, it's a lot of pressure on us. And we also have to hold ourselves gently. So for me, it's just acknowledging that, one, you know, I'm a loving caregiver who will do what I can do to make sure I set my kids up for success, safety, security, and the tools needed to be successful. But I can only control so much. Beyond that, there's so much that's out of my control, and that's worrisome. I can acknowledge and accept the fact that I'm feeling worried. And by acknowledging the normalcy of that worry and getting to the point of accepting that that worry may always be there, but we can tame it a bit. So that it's not in the forefront, but it's there in the background, right? It's when we focus on the worry and feel that I can't move on until I've thought of everything that can go wrong and done everything to minimize things that can go wrong, then the worry will continue to be in the forefront. But if you can find that sweet spot of acceptance, hey, I've done what I can reasonably do to ensure my child's success, their safety, their security, their growth, and I know that I can't control everything.
I'm curious to hear how, if there are other tools that would be helpful for parents and caregivers as they navigate confronting some of those same emotions and fears that oftentimes the kids are experiencing that are frequently shelved by the parents in terms of how they're feeling about it in order to hold space for the child's feelings. How can parents and caregivers take care of themselves?
Major question that we've dealt with over the past 3 years as dealing with this mental health crisis for youth that we've had to experience in our country, that COVID has really exacerbated, but it's really been there for a much longer time than COVID's been around. I don't think that social media has done us many favors when it comes to managing our own stress, putting down the phone or the screen or the tablet, getting outside into natural sunlight, making sure that our sleep is high quality and of a quantity that would be recommended. So I think getting back to basics, going on family walks, getting back connected to nature, social connections are really important. So really relying on the social peer groups, right? So neighbors, family, friends, church, and religious or spiritual communities, online groups. There's so many ways to connect. And we know that connecting to a trusted peer group, we know, is one of the best protective factors that can help parents buffer against stress.
Pediatric psychologist Jeff Shahidullah, thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nicole Ellis.